a little bit about why I don't think it's a perfect diet for all of us. I think a lot of gurus are going to tell you, like, they've got the answer for you, and, like, I think most of us know that it's kind of, all of us are individual. I kind of want to talk about why there's no perfect diet for everybody. I also want to talk about some of the current trends, like where the evidence seems to be pushing people as far as where the research is going, the different diets that are showing the most promise. I want to definitely bust some myths about protein and fat and carbs.
Yes.
And then we're going to do a helicopter view of 5 or 6 major diets right now that I think are worth paying attention to.
Awesome.
Just kind of like little cliff notes of like some of the major books out right now. So here's a Bruce Lee quote. Here's what we're starting with. And this is what I want to kind of encourage you guys to do, because there's a lot of stuff that I'm going to be talking about today that probably isn't relevant to you. Like one of the main examples I've been thinking about lately is fasting. You know, it's funny how I think like a lot of life falls into 80-20 kind of distributions, where 80% of, you know, falls in one category and 20% in another. And I think that fasting is like really hitting a peak because it's so good for so many people, especially in our modern society right now. And I would estimate probably like 80% of people would benefit from fasting a little bit more and taking more breaks from food.
Yeah.
But there are definitely some of us that have the opposite problem. You know, there's like those old categories of endomorphs and ectomorphs. And there's like people that have an easy time gaining weight, people that have a hard time gaining weight.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot that goes into that. It could be your gut, could be faster metabolisms, but it can also be your schedule and how you just have a hard time even finding time to eat and take time for yourself. And so for people that have a hard time getting enough nutrients throughout the day, like fasting is obviously and definitely not for you. That's like the lowest on your priority list. Because I think a lot of health is a balance between being anabolic and being catabolic, right? You guys know what I mean by that? Like, anabolic is in that state of building where your body is just flooded with nutrients.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a little bit of an idea in gym culture that you want to be anabolic like 100% of the time. And like you always want to be flooding yourself with nutrients and pre-workout and peri-workout and post-workout and flooding yourself with protein and carbs. I really think that's the wrong idea. I think that the balance of catabolism, which is the opposite of that, where you're forcing your body to break down your own fat, your own proteins, to get rid of those weaker tissues is really a key as well. So you don't need to be eating all the time. But for some of us, that's not a problem. You know, I think 20% of us, those endomorphs who are like really skinny and maybe a little more anxious and feel stressed, and they need to just find more times to like deep breathe and actually take a meal. They need to just be eating whenever they can. Don't need to be worrying about like restricting their eating window and fasting. You guys all heard of intermittent fasting a little bit? Just get some general context. So as we're going through today, just like think about Bruce Lee, like a lot of the stuff has no relevance to you, but I bet all of us, I don't think any of us are gonna like radically change our diets anytime soon, but it's gonna be at this point more about tweaking little things and figuring out, you know, little things we can add, take away, so that's kind of what I'm thinking about today. So something I've really been thinking about a lot, there's this brand new book by Rob Wolf called Wired to Eat. I don't know if you guys have heard of this guy. Rob Wolf is one of the main popularizers of the paleo diet probably 10 years ago with a book called The Paleo Solution. And he really speaks to me because he comes from a biochemistry background. But he has this really interesting test in this brand new book. This one came out this year. He's talking a little bit more about personalized diets and why the same diet doesn't work for everybody, even within paleo. So he took this test and he kind of put his own spin on it. It's a very classic test in medicine. But he did a fasted glucose test with a simple precision extra glucose monitor 2 hours after he took 50 grams of carbs. Fasted, so like first thing in the morning, it's the first thing they ate. And he just picked his 7 favorite sources of carbohydrates that he likes to eat throughout the week. So this is just some examples, but it could be different for everybody. It could be white rice for our family, but would it probably be like white rice and potatoes, sweet potatoes, like our favorite carbs. So that would probably be our 7. We haven't quite done this yet, but Heather has been testing her blood sugar a little bit because she's in her third trimester and women all have to get tested for gestational diabetes. So we've been thinking about this a little more. It's kind of interesting. And what Rob found was that he and his wife have vastly different responses to these 7 different carbohydrates.
Interesting.
Like his wife's blood sugar could be rock steady, and they were also doing even continuous glucose monitoring, so you could see like the whole curve.
Wow.
And he and his wife would just have completely different responses, which is kind of a mind-blowing thing, and like definitely something that research is just kind of catching up to, is that your gut bacteria actually affects the way you process sugar and carbs and fibers. And that can even change from year to year, from day to day even. You get a bug, or you're taking antibiotics, and suddenly you're not digesting food the same way, and that food that felt great a couple weeks ago now suddenly doesn't. That could totally be possible, because I really think that gut bacteria really affects the way that you digest food. I don't think it's that big of a leap. It's just not a ton of research, but it's all like brand new. We're getting a lot of those mouse and rat studies and like starting to move into humans as far as the effects of your gut bacteria on the whole range of health conditions. So it's pretty cool, and the reason you care about blood sugar is because for a whole host of long-term health effects, you want your blood sugar to be steady and generally low for most of your life. That's why there's this test called the hemoglobin A1C test. Doctors will take, and it's like a marker in your blood that's like a representation of the last 3 months of your blood sugar and how steady has it been, has it been spiking. So that's why it's a really useful test, because it gives them kind of a picture of overall, there's this molecule that kind of shows its own picture of how your blood sugar's been going up and down. So for anything from, you know, clogged arteries, you know, heart health, all that stuff, you really want your blood sugar to be steady and low. Part of why keto is so good is because you really don't even have to worry about spiking your blood sugar, because it's just low all the time, because you just really don't have a lot of blood sugar floating around anyway. So sugar's not bad. I mean, I think we all do need carbs. There is not a single competitive CrossFit athlete who sticks to strict keto. Like, I did a lot of research into what the different athletes are eating. Not a single one. Not even a single one sticks to strict paleo.
Wow.
And I think a lot of that is because it's just hard to eat enough, especially when they're competing. Like, a lot of them are very strict in their training season.
Really?
But then you get to the competition for those couple of weeks, and they're literally going out to eat and eating burgers and just, like, whatever they can, because they've just done so many workouts and they've just been moving all day. And I think that could be an issue of, like, not that you need to go off paleo, but that it's just hard to eat as much food as those people need in those times, and sometimes you just gotta go for the hyper palatable.
It's interesting. Because one thing I've been feeling lately is I'm super hungry all the time. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not getting enough food from keto. That's what I feel like. I have to eat something.
Yeah.
So I made keto pancakes the other day. I literally ate like almost 10. I mean, they're smaller, but it was just like, I need more. I can feel it. I haven't eaten enough. So
that is a really an issue with a lot of diets, right? I think the reason a lot of diets work for what most people want, which is the weight loss in the short term, is because whenever you take out a bunch of foods that you normally eat, typically you tend to eat less food than you were just a few days before, right?
Yes.
So like almost all diets work in some way because they're kind of restricting your calories in some way because you're just taking away certain foods.
That's the same thing. I'm always one of those too. Handfuls of nuts, or hey, there's a hot dog, like anything.
Yeah.
Just give me something.
Yeah. It's hard to get enough food, and like, especially on a diet as restricted as keto, I think there's a couple things going into that. Like, that could be your muscles just asking for glycogen, because in some ways I do think you need to refeed when you're doing such intense glycolytic workouts. I think you do need to refeed, and like, hunger can be a lot of different signals. It's hard to kind of differentiate. There's like different kinds of hunger, you know? Like, it's kind of just like a broad, by the time it hits your frontal cortex and you kind of process it, you're like, I'm hungry, but you don't always know what part of your body's like asking for nutrients. It's kind of the way that I think about it. And like, it could be a certain mineral, like maybe you really need potassium or something, and like your body's telling you eat a banana, but like, it's not really the sugar. Sometimes it is the carbs though. It's hard to figure that out sometimes. But like, I think that the problem with keto long term is that it is hard to eat enough. Like, a lot of people do keto and you feel great for a while because you probably are accidentally calorie restricting, but most people have a ton of body fat to lose.
Yeah.
And so you're packed with energy, tens of thousands of calories, most people, but not everybody, depending on your body type, right? Most people, and once you go keto, your body's just gonna start burning that fat so easily because your metabolism's adapted. But there's gonna be a certain point where like, you're already at the right body fat percentage for your hormones to be healthy. And then at that point, you're gonna start getting a crisis where your body's gonna be like, do I start breaking down tissues that we actually need, or do we just lower your overall energy, like just reduce the metabolism a little bit because we just don't have enough calories to fuel what we're trying to do?
Wow.
So we don't want to keep dipping into those body fat stores because that's what, like, starvation stores, just like levels of hierarchy there.
Wow.
So
that's real.
Yeah, so we'll talk about keto. There's a couple different versions of keto that I think actually work better, more for athletes. There's a couple different spins on it, so we'll get there. Yeah.
Super good.
Cool, so this is just a couple of the preliminary studies right now. This is all from the last 10 years of research into how your gut bacteria affects how you actually metabolize carbs. So this is a study they did where they took a couple rats. They have a typical drinking solution of water and sugar. But for some of the rats, they put in a bunch of artificial sweeteners, sucralose, aspartame, and saccharin. Those rats had a change in gut bacteria that led to significantly impaired glucose metabolism, which is the precursor to type 2 diabetes.
Yeah, and Diet Coke anymore.
Yeah, it's these three, too, man. So that's all that took. That was the only change. And suddenly these rats start looking like they're pre-diabetic, start getting that insulin resistance that we're all trying to avoid.
Yeah.
Because insulin resistance means we can't actually easily use that blood sugar, get it out of our bloodstream, and then it's just circulating, causing damage.
So all the diet stuff changes your gut bacteria and makes you blue.
It really could. It could end up causing more damage. Yeah, it's really interesting.
Does Splenda equal Intima? Or no, just...
Aspartame. I actually don't remember which brand name.
I think they changed the name of aspartame, didn't they?
Yeah.
To like those sneaky bastards.
They're always changing the brand.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's been a while since I tried them. I still will use stevia occasionally, but yeah. Even stevia has been shown to alter gut bacteria already. They don't know how it affects your health, but it definitely alters gut bacteria. So I'm just really cautious about that. Don't overdo it. It's like, oh, it's natural. It seems good.
Sure.
But like, your gut bacteria affects so much of your life. But like, I don't like to like. It's like your garden. Like you're trying to like tend to it.
Totally.
One more study that was kind of interesting. This is like, so part of the reason. So they test all women when they hit the third trimester for diabetes because there are significant gut changes that happen all throughout pregnancy. But there's a significant change that happens right on the third trimester that causes some women to become insulin resistant enough that they are temporarily basically diabetic and they have to go even on insulin or metformin now. They're starting to put some pregnant women on metformin for a couple of months.
Yeah.
Kind of interesting.
Yep.
So, and they actually did this test where they just took rats, took a woman in her first trimester, took her gut bacteria, put it in a rat. Rat was fine, or mouse was fine. Took a third trimester woman's gut bacteria, put it in a mouse, and they started getting desensitized to insulin. So, more and more links to like gut bacteria really affects everything, and like we're all different, right? Even if you're living in the same house, drinking out of the same cup, like we all have different gut bacteria. So,
wow,
very interesting. So one way you can kind of get a peek into your particular garden at the moment is there's a couple of companies right now that are really diving into this space. This is cool, you know, like this is basically medicine. But it's kind of like they're working in a loophole. Like this is more like a Silicon Valley startup environment where the self-quantification movement isn't as regulated, and there's like a bunch of startups that are just throwing money into this field of basically they send you a kit in a box, you take your poop, you put it in something, you send it back to them, and they give you this whole report, and there's like a bunch of different services to do this of what's going on in your gut at that moment. And like it's almost even interesting to do it if you're significantly changing your diet, if you're going on keto, or like you feel different than you did. It changes over time, right? But it's also good to kind of see where you're at. So this is a company called Viome that I'm really a big fan of. I'm a big fan of the founder. I like kind of his philosophy and business, but also they have a little bit more of an advanced test where they can give you a fuller picture where most of the companies only give you bacteria. These guys also give you virus and fungus and like all the things in your gut. And then what's cool is you can open up your app and they tell you what your superfoods are for your current gut bacteria. So basically like these are the foods that you're current gut bacteria are good at breaking down to give you the nutrients. I think a lot of stomach upset, you know, irritation in your gut when you eat certain foods is if you don't have the gut bacteria that's prepared to break down those fibers, you end up just passing through larger chunks of food that can end up causing a lot of irritation in your gut. And so it's really important to just figure out what food, like it's not just you are what you eat, it's like you are what the bacteria in your eating is able to break down and then you're able to eat. Like they are really that first line of defense for most things. Some stuff you kind of absorb immediately. The most fibers and that important stuff does need to be broken down by that bacteria. So it's pretty cool. These guys, yeah, they had cucumber, sauerkraut, spinach, chicken breast. I pulled up somebody else's results, and they had spinach and garlic and beef.
So
they
can
take some joke, man. This probably sounds more like what I'm like craving these days, but I haven't taken the test. I'd love to see what my foods are. And they give you this whole list if you have to do this test. It's like $100-$200 of like, here are the foods you can indulge in. Here's the foods you can eat, you know, as much as you want. Here's the foods you can eat, you know, in restriction.
It's so funny. I've been eating the pickles that you sell, that really good brand.
Yeah.
I literally feel better.
That juice is great too. Don't throw out that juice. You can use that in sauces or
just
drink it in shots. It's really healthy.
So, I mean, is there an element of also if you eat, because I'm kind of bad on eating the same food every day.
Yeah. I don't know if that's necessarily bad. Yeah.
But like, if you eat the same thing over and over again, that you're like, what I expect my list to be pretty much what I eat.
Yeah.
Is what they're accustomed to getting.
Maybe. And if you think you're already optimal, but like, you don't necessarily know, right? I mean, like, and this is still pretty new. I think this information is coming out, but you might be surprised. Like, I actually haven't taken the test. Like, I don't know. Maybe it'll be obvious, but maybe it'll be like, oh man, I do feel great when I eat that food, but I only eat it that one time. That person made it for me. Yeah, I'm not sure. Like, I'm always like, I get caught in like eating the same foods, like Brussels sprouts and ground beef, like the same stuff.
Chocolate bars.
But if you're like picking really nutrient dense stuff,
dogs.
I don't think
that's
bad.
I
think that's good for you. Yeah. Cool. So that's a little bit of all. I don't think there's like a personalized diet for everybody. So now I'm gonna kind of bust a couple of myths and like help you guys kind of read labels effectively for protein, fat, and carbs. Like this is a little bit of my background. Like I come from a biochemistry background, and our whole year is basically divided up into protein, fats, and carbs, and breaking down how they work kind of mechanically and structurally. So. I want to talk about protein first because you know we're here in a gym and like we're in this like protein culture, like I mentioned earlier, like it's anabolic culture. People think they always need to be anabolic, having your protein shake. You got to slam that protein shake right after your workout all the time. I don't actually think that's a good idea. In fact, I want to kind of differentiate between hypertrophy and strength. because I feel like a lot of gym culture still in CrossFit, even though our goal here in this gym is for performance, it's for work capacity, it's for strength, right? Like, we're not actually going for hypertrophy.
Yeah.
But so much of gym culture is flavored by bodybuilding and magazines and looks, right? And like Instagram models now. It's not just magazines, it's Instagram too, and like looking good in the mirror. And that's all about hypertrophy. Like, those guys might not necessarily perform well. In fact, a lot of them are dehydrated and have these big balloon muscles that aren't actually that strong and functional.
Yeah,
like
that's
not what you want. Like, muscle weighs pounds, right? And like, when you're on a bar, it's weighing you down if it's not helping you. And so I feel like not flooding you don't actually need the biggest muscles possible. Like, people kind of get tripped up on that, I think, in a gym. You don't need to be flooding your body, but you just need to be strong. And like, a big component of strength is not just the size of your muscle cells, but also the neural connection strength leading to those muscles, right? And like, that isn't necessarily increased by just slamming protein powders. That's more just like reps and time under tension and practice, right? And like, letting those nerves really develop and like sending those signals repeatedly to help those nerves to strengthen.
That's good.
So I think it's like more important, like, you really don't need that much protein, and like, the dangers of overconsuming protein are for sure real.
Yeah.
Like, the actual daily value of protein is so small compared to where we are now, and like, in the first world, I think we're just so skewed. Like, there's so many people in other parts of the world that eat so much less protein than we do. Like, the actual amount of protein that an average man needs is about 55 to 70 grams of protein, depending on your body weight, right? It's about 0.6 grams per kilogram. But people these days are eating a gram per pound or more of protein. From somebody my size, that's like 200 grams of protein. Like, I've tried to do that, like, back in the day. It's actually really hard and it sucks. Yeah. And like, I looked up, so there's like definitely some dangers. So in the last time I talked about meta-analyses, I did a meta-analysis search of protein overconsumption, and they classified in the meta-analyses that I found overconsumption of protein as just 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight or higher. Which is like 80 or 90 grams of protein for somebody my size. Like, it's not even that much, but it's like, once you start supplementing with protein, it's easy to get to 100 grams of protein or more per day.
Yes.
And the dangers are like, it's like your kidney, your liver, cancer, it sucks calcium out of your bones, like all these dangers, and like, not a lot of benefits. Like, high protein diets are relatively new as far as research, but it's like, we've got this whole industry, and like, you don't want to be like too skeptical or like conspiracy theory, but you know that these supplement companies are always looking for a way to take a cheap ingredient and make it expensive and upsell it to you. And I think protein powders are a big part of that. I think they're just like taking cheap milk, like commercially processed milk, and like extracting it. And like, you can talk about how you process the whey protein all you want, but like, that's still, like, they're taking a lot of the nutrients out, and then I don't even know if you necessarily need that protein. Now, if we're talking about the 80-20 thing, I think for the 20% of us that have a hard time getting enough food and a hard time getting enough calories, those people I think are perfect candidates for protein powders and protein supplements. And like, making sure if you actually have a hard time getting enough protein, then something hyper palatable that tastes like chocolate cheesecake and comes in a can, like, that's actually probably a good idea. Get that couple extra 100 calories in, that's probably what your body needs to like send that signal to like, you're okay, right? Right, that just depends. Totally depends. Yeah. So.
But what about, I'm
sorry. Yeah, no, go. Yeah.
So we're pretty active in here.
Yeah.
I would think that I need more protein than the guy on the street.
Definitely.
And tearing stuff down.
Definitely. I think for you, a good test would be to remove the hyper palatable protein sources. Remove those protein powders that taste like dessert, and just see how much chicken breast or steak you can actually eat. And I think your body will kind of tell you, it's really hard to overeat chicken breast, but it's easy to slam an extra 60 or 40 grams of protein from shake.
All I do is that right there.
Yeah.
And I don't even do it every day.
Yeah.
It's just like,
I would just like see if you can taste it and see if your hunger is still telling you.
Usually I go home and eat dinner, so I don't do it. But like, if I can't eat right away, I'll just take that.
I think that's a perfect candidate, right?
Yeah.
If that's what your body's asking for, and that's what you just can't get that other quality protein source, makes a lot of sense, right? Yeah. Especially that's more to the new people in the gym that come in with like the brand new Reebok everything and like the protein shaker full of protein powder. It's like, don't eat that, dude. Like, you probably ate so much today already. Like, you're good. So.
It is true. I mean, you probably touched on this. It is true that we actually refueling our glucose stores right after a workout is probably way better.
Actually, there's no evidence for the post workout window.
Okay.
Really don't need it. In fact, Mark Sisson, one of my heroes in paleo, he's a big time longevity guy, super fit for his age at around 60. He actually sees in himself a little bit of a spike in testosterone and growth hormone if he holds off on eating for a couple of hours after his workout. So he just has like some water, maybe some minerals and stuff, and lets his body kind of kind of repair itself sometimes after a real heavy workout. I think there's some room for both. I think like developing that kind of metabolic flexibility is really good,
yes.
Like giving your body those different. So I just don't. You definitely don't need it every time,
okay.
And I would even question if you need it at all necessarily. But if you are not getting enough food in the day and like you need that protein, that's a perfect time to do it. Like you're already hungry, you feel ready.
Yeah.
That's like a good reward for yourself.
I mean,
some people
it's totally real. It's like I mean, there's probably days where like I don't eat or do anything for a couple hours.
Yeah.
After like 2 or 3 hours, I start to feel like I need to eat.
Yeah,
but
sure,
I don't necessarily
sure.
feel that 45
right away.
Minutes after.
For sure,
no.
I don't either. I feel really good. I feel light. I
yeah,
feel like
exactly.
My water. I don't
just
need to slam food right away.
Yeah.
It can actually be really good for you. So, yeah, I don't think you really need to. And I think as long as you're just getting enough nutrients overall, you're gonna be in enough. If you're building muscle that night, the next day, like you don't need to build muscle right in that hour right after your workout. You know what I mean? Like your body's got time to recover. I think.
Hmm.
Also, the complete protein myth. No need to worry about complete protein. Like. That's like if you're only eating 30 or 40 grams and you're a vegan and it's only coming from rice, maybe that's an issue. But if you're at all eating a normal amount of protein and eating meat at all, nothing to worry about there. Same with BCAAs, I think that's like another one of those products that I think are just kind of upsold by the nutrition industry. It's very, very little evidence. There's like a little bit of evidence, it's got some effects, but I don't think there's necessarily a need to take those BCAAs in isolation. Like a normal high quality protein is about 25 to 30% BCAAs naturally. Like you're already getting all those amino acids. They're just like taking it out, repackaging it, adding some more flavors, and like if you need protein, like I don't know, I see a lot of athletes doing it, but they're all sponsored by those BCAA companies for the most part. Like I don't think they'd be investing their money in those BCAAs to be honest if they weren't sponsored. So that's just kind of my opinion on that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but definitely open. There are definitely some studies on BCAAs that show small health effects, but they can also blunt the recovery from exercise as well. So it's definitely mixed. Cool. That's protein. Couple things I want to touch on with fat. Anything else you guys want to talk about for protein or you're over here kind of keep it
open? I want to hear about fat.
Yeah, I love fat, right? So one thing I do want to touch on, since we're kind of talking about food and diet today, is the oxidization of fat and how the way that you cook the fat before you eat it definitely matters.
Oh, okay.
Really does. Like if you were gonna like char, you had like a nice fatty steak, but that's so nutrient dense. If you char that thing all the way through, that those molecules are like irreversibly changed, and the nutrients are not the same.
Yeah.
Fat oxidizes.
You were.
Like when they talk about the smoke point, with different oils, that's what they're talking about. Like different cooking oils, that's all the temperature at which those fat molecules start to oxidize in that particular oil. So olive oil is in like mid to high 300s. Coconut oil, refined, you can start pushing to like 400 or so. Like depending on the oil, they start to smoke it different because they're just different stabilities. Fish oil, if you were to pour fish oil into a pan, it's going to start oxidizing as soon as you start eating it up, really about 200, 250. So it just, but really, like, they're just not as healthy. Like, there's some studies that show that a little bit of oxidized cholesterol, like, for example, a little bit of that char on the outside of the steak that might still be rare on the inside, can actually boost testosterone and things like that. Just a little bit, though, but I don't think it's actually good for you. It's maybe more of like a hormetic, like, an effect to your body that, like,
okay.
There's probably some more meat and like testosterone.
Just feel like a man
fueling steaks coming. But I think the real nutrients are in the middle of that steak, around the char, where that fat is still maybe a little bit marbled and melted, but like not damaged. So if you want to cook your meat all the way through, like a slow cooker is a great way to do that. But just like not exposing it to super high heat for a long time is going to keep those fat molecules intact and allow those nutrients to remain.
What about butter?
Yeah. What about it? Like cooking with it?
Heating it up.
You know, it's funny. I
was
actually,
pouring that on stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Brown butter is like put in the culinary area. I really think that's a completely different food. I think the healthy butter, I don't even like to cook with butter. I think that's almost a waste. I think butter is so full of nutrients and like cholesterol and like all those healthy fats. I just let it kind of melt onto my food at the end.
Okay.
But I don't like to saute with it even. I like to saute with a much higher smoke point oil, like a refined coconut or an olive oil or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just don't like to cook with super high heat. I like to grill just to get a little bit of flavor on the outside, but I really like most of my food to be on the raw or side. Egg yolks especially. Egg yolks, full of cholesterol, full of fat, both of those are easily oxidizing. Oxidized cholesterol is what leads to things like atherosclerosis, can actually clog your arteries. Super overcooking your egg yolks so they're like gray and chalky. That is, I think, way worse for your heart and your arteries than you try to eat those egg yolks when they're still kind of soft and silky and just barely cooked. Almost or raw. Yeah, I'll totally slip a raw yolk every once in a while. Just crave it sometimes.
Rocky.
Yeah, just like Rocky, man. Exactly. You knew what he was doing.
That
egg yolks are like a health food.
They're so good for you.
So,
every morning,
it's just
straight
five raw eggs.
It's That's what the strong man competitors do, man. These guys who have to eat like 12,000 calories per day, you gotta eat food. It's like the only way to get down that much food. It's intense.
An over easy egg is a rye egg yolk. You just don't think of it like that.
Yeah, you just don't think about it.
What is?
Yeah,
an over easy egg.
Yeah, it's
just surrounded with cooked egg white.
Right.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah. So I'm going to do a little breakdown of like what polymono and saturated fat means. This is what you see on labels and stuff. I'm going to give you some context. So what we're talking about is basically being a little chemical. This is like the most boring slide of the day. But I love this stuff. Yeah, some chemistry. So this is a short chain fatty acid. You can tell because of how short it is. And when you say saturated, what we mean is it's saturated with the amount of hydrogens. Basically, the maximum amount of hydrogens are attaching to every single carbon molecule all the way down. When you talk about unsaturated, mono or poly, we're talking about one or more double bonds here or here that mean you can't attach as many hydrogens. So they're not quite saturated with the maximum amount of hydrogens in that molecule. And the way that it affects in our bodies and the solution beforehand is like, basically when you think about it, when you zoom in on this stuff, all of life is moving all the time. Everything wiggles and spins, even down to like the tiniest molecular level. You look at a microscope. Everything moves, even these little fat molecules, they're all kind of shifting, moving at all times. And when they're fully saturated, all these joints are fully articulating, but as soon as you start introducing double bonds, it puts a kink in the system, and it has to kind of move around it, but that this bond can no longer freely rotate around those double bonds. It just kind of changes the way that molecule floats and spins around its space. They're not as flexible. And so that kind of affects things in a bunch of different ways. One of the ways it affects it is why some cooking oils are liquid on your counter and some are solid on your counter, and the reason for that is just kind of the energetic state that they find themselves in. So these are all our poly and our monounsaturated fats with those kinks from the double bonds, and you can see they're all kind of shaky in real life, but they can't quite pack into an energetically as stable of a position because they have those kinks, and they can't just get flat and go into that perfect spot. So this would be your liquid cooking oil, because they're not quite as dense and condensed in there. This would be your solid cooking oil. So your cooking oils that have a lot more poly and mono unsaturated fats, like your olive oil and your vegetable oils, those are all the liquid ones. Your saturated fats, like your butter and your cotalo, your coconut oil, that's why it ends up being solid. It's just because those long saturated molecules are a little more flexible. They can get a nice compact position. So
coconut oil is like, it's like liquid in the summer and hard.
Yeah, so coconut oil actually contains a lot of these MCT oil, which are a short chain fatty acid. And they are fully saturated, but those just don't pack as well because they're so small. And so MCT itself is actually liquid.
Okay.
And so because coconut oil is a mix of longer chain saturated fats and the MCTs, it's like right on the brink. So as soon as you start to heat it up to like body temperature, it melts.
Okay.
So it's like, yeah, right in the middle there. So it's all about the ratio of like saturated to liquid fats. Okay, so yeah, I want to talk about trans fats for a second, just because you guys have that context of what hydrogenation means, and now you kind of understand what a trans fat actually is and why it's bad for you. So basically, it's like this new industrial process in the last few decades of hydrogenation that's leading to trans fats. And what happens basically is they're taking one of our more poly or monounsaturated fats, like a more vegetable heavy oil, but they want to make it stiffer and solid.
So no, excuse me.
Yeah. Morning. So it's like they're trying to take these liquid fats and make them solid because it's hard to make biscuits out of vegetable oil, but you can make biscuits out of Crisco, and it's hard to get like pastry texture. It's all about texture and flavor. It's like a food additive thing. So they're trying to make these fats that are liquid and already probably unhealthy for you more like a solid fat and act more like a coconut oil or a tallow or something like that. And so what they do is they just bubble hydrogen through the solution. That's called hydrogenation, just like super concentrated hydrogen bubbles through. And eventually the hydrogens start to attach and start to remove some of those double bonds. Mm-hmm. The problem is, and since this hydrogenation process is random, those hydrogen atoms in almost equal parts will either attach cis, both on the same side, or trans, on opposite sides. In nature, it only happens in this configuration because these molecules are kind of put together piece by piece by these kind of molecular processes. And for whatever reason, this only occurs in like very, very, very trace amounts in nature. Like you can find it if you look hard enough, but basically there's no nutritional value for trans fats, like, and there's tons of health dangers. Like really it's like one of those avoid at all costs kind of things. There's just nothing good about it for you. Your body can handle a tiny trace amount, but it's like the less the better. So something like full of a hydrogenated oil, like a margarine, can contain up to 40% trans fat.
So don't rework it.
Yeah, no need. And really, it gets even trickier, and this is where labeling gets so messed up, because you'll see on labels sometimes 0 grams of trans fats per serving. That actually gives me pause because I'm like, why are you even talking about trans fat in the first place? It's per serving. It's because it's all about rounding on these nutritional labels. And if you look at the back on this particular one, like the second or third ingredient is partially hydrogenated palm oil. So they're starting to like take whatever unsaturated polyunsaturated fats, hydrogenate them to get the texture they want, and they're totally creating trans fats in the process. And it's just because it's less than 0.5 or 1 gram, they can say.
So it's 0.4 per serving.
Yeah, it's probably like, it literally
probably 0.9 per serving.
Yeah, it's so messed up. Like another one I found was Coffee Mate. Yeah, it's 0 grams trans fat, is that little thing right there. And then you look on the back, sugar, vegetables, so partially hydrogenated, like the second ingredient. So, yeah, just avoid. Just avoid the front. I just go straight to the ingredients on the back. Like, they do list, hopefully, everything that's in there. Even though, like, nowadays they get around it sometimes with, like, natural flavors. Like, what is a natural flavor? Like, it could be a billion different things.
I've heard just avoid vegetable oil in general.
Avoid what kind of oil?
Avoid vegetable oil.
Yeah.
Is that, like, pretty
good? I would totally go with that. Yeah. I really think that the reason it's so prevalent these days is partly due to, like, subsidies for farms. They could just have abundant amounts of, like,
corn. So much corn.
And they're just trying to find subsidies with it. And there's extracting oil, even though it's not a very high oil food. And the oil itself is just not that healthy for you. It really is just
it
like.
It tastes good.
Yeah, it's just like there's so many benefits otherwise to things like olive oil and coconut oil.
Right.
Yeah, okay. Just like for the omega 6-3 balance off on all of those. Yeah, I think in general, just avoid it. Yeah.
Good to know.
Cool. All
right.
His almonds are amazing.
Oh, yeah, good. Yeah, we got snacks here because one time. Yeah, because we're coming late. Someone's talking about carbs a little bit too. So now that I know what we know about gut biomes, right? How everybody digests carbs different, I would encourage you to look at glycemic index now as like kind of like a general guideline at best of how foods will respond in your body because all of us are different. So it's like, that's like one test they did in like some subjects, but it does not represent how it's gonna affect your own blood sugar. So just because something on a package of your protein bar says low glycemic, like that has no necessary bearing on like how it's gonna affect you and your own blood sugar. Because all of us digest that stuff different. The different fibers they use might not spike the blood sugar in one person, but might really spike it in another person. And like, especially these days, you know, companies like Quest are like using some weird fibers and sugars that I don't know how they affect your metabolism. They're using like brand new stuff that like is kind of just getting created, like allulose and stuff. So
you're talking about the oligosaccharides too.
There's a lot of those too, and that's a particular fiber that's fermented by gut bacteria. But some people specifically have to avoid those. People on a diet called the low FODMAP diet, they eat anything like that, and like their gut just blows up because they don't have the gut bacteria that can really handle it properly. So it just it really depends on the person, I think, like how it affects your body for sure.
Yeah. There's not enough research about oligosaccharides yet. You know, it's prebiotic, but
we know it occurs naturally in foods in some amount. Like you'll get like a gram or two, if you eat a bunch of vegetables, but like 20 grams of it as the only sweetener in a protein bar, it's gonna start working about. That's gonna affect your gut.
Exactly.
That's interesting. So glycemic index, just approach with caution. Resistant starch is cool. So just like fats, when they change nutritionally when you cook them, there's a cool new thing kind of discovering about some starches, especially the starch in white potatoes and rice and oats, that they change when you cook them, and like it's going to affect your blood sugar completely differently based on how you prepare the food. And kind of instinctively, we all know that. Like potatoes are so interesting. It's so funny. Potatoes are like simultaneously the most palatable and one of the least palatable foods, depending on how you prepare it. Like potato chips are one of the most common foods for people to overeat. Like you just eat even if you aren't actually hungry, but a baked potato, like try to overeat a bit. Like you'll eat two and you're like, I literally can't eat anymore. And like that's a cool kind of test for yourself to like see, am I actually hungry or is this food just like, could I eat a baked potato right now?
Wow.
Resistant starch is cool. So when you cool resistant starch, the starch turns into a more gooey, and you can just put a baked potato in the fridge and like the texture is completely different the next day. Oatmeal too, it gets like kind of gooey and gummy.
Yeah.
That starch actually changes irreversibly into something called resistant starch, where it forms this coating around itself in that cooking and cooling process. And the cooling part is very important. So when you make that white rice and it's all like fluffy and hot when you first make it and eat it, that's like instant sugar to your bloodstream. Like you are literally absorbing that already in your mouth. The starch is breaking down by the amylase. Instant sugar. If you take that same white rice and you cool it overnight in the fridge and you eat spoonfuls, it's gonna affect your blood sugar almost zero.
Because
almost all that starch has been converted to resistant starch, which actually doesn't even end up as blood sugar at all. So resistant starch, it's called that because it resists digestion in your stomach. So it makes it all the way to your intestines, and then the bacteria in your intestines actually breaks down into short-chain fatty acids. You actually end up getting fat from that resistant starch. So even though it's still labeled as carbs on a nutrition label, it doesn't. It actually, by the time it hits your body, it's actually fat. It's like that exact, almost that exact fat molecule that I showed on the very top, that short chain fatty acid. So that's what those bacteria end up breaking down. They end up also breaking down to things like butyrate, other really beneficial molecules.
Wow.
But it's actually really cool. So it's not just like a delayed effect on your blood sugar. If you prepare carbs in certain ways, it's like zero effect. So
it
really varies.
And you reheat it.
Yeah, so you reheat it. Some of it, most of it stays in resistant starch. Like you'll heat up some of it and it gets a little bit more like easily digested to sugar again. But then I've actually seen studies that show that repeated heating and cooling cycles will increase that amount of resistant starch each time. So cooking it does reduce it a little bit, but some of it does stay in our resistance. So it is better in general. If you're just gonna have, if you love your warm rice, cooking it, cooling it, and then heating it up again, it's gonna end up having much less of an effect on the blood sugar than just eating it right out of the pan. It's like, it's so good. Like you can taste how it's like a different starch. Like it's just so, just different at all in your tongue.
It's more bland after it's been cooked and cooled and cooked.
Yeah,
and cooled.
It forms that kind of a little bit more chalky, and like it's a different starch, yeah. But your body can tell the difference.
Okay, like, what's old oatmeal?
Yeah, old oatmeal, man. That's like the worst. It's super weird, yeah. The cold oats, too. Now, like, there's this whole movement on Instagram of like overnight oats recipes, like pretty. That actually really maximizes the resistant starch if you keep it cold that way, even in the raw form, the full resistant starch, much less of an effect on your blood sugar than if you're just eating a big bowl of hot.
Where do we get a list of that?
What's that?
Where do I get a list of resistant starches?
You know, there's not that many. Yeah, you know, as far as paleo sources, the best one is green plantains. But it's really like, you get some from grains, like cold pasta also starts to form resistant starch. You can see like cold pasta is kind of chalky,
yeah.
It starts to change as well. Cold potatoes, cold rice, and oats are the main starches. But then green bananas as well.
I've been making those cold oats, remember?
Yeah.
I
love cold oats, yeah.
Did you hear that thing about the cold potato diet? On, I think it was the Rhonda Patrick. Maybe she talked about
no,
it.
No, I haven't heard about that.
Oh no, Chris Kresser.
Okay,
he was talking
Kresser
about
was the cold potato diet.
He's a big guy of like functional diets, and he tailors diets to specific people. He says if someone's really just trying to lose weight as fast as they possibly can, he'll literally tell them to eat nothing but potatoes. Because exactly what you said, you can't overeat.
You can't overeat that unpalatable.
And you're
yeah.
changing your mental your mental kind of processing your food as well.
Yeah.
And the resistant starch, because you're going to make a ton of potatoes, and then half of them are going to cool. So then they turn into resistant starch.
Got it.
So he literally would just tell people to eat potatoes.
Whoa.
Like literally nothing
yeah.
but baked potatoes if they're trying to like aggressively lose weight as fast as
they
can.
I did a kind of a personal experiment where I really maximized resistant starch in my diet for about 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Getting to the point where you can just get the Bob's Red Mill potato starch powder. And that's basically cold potato starch powder that like is just basically pure resistant starch. And you can like mix it into a smoothie or something and like I definitely felt good, but my farts were tremendous. It was not so recommended. Like they didn't like smell, not to be like too in depth, but like there was like trumpets. I could tell like there was like some new stuff happening down the teeth in my guts. It was so weird. Yeah. It's funny how that affects that stuff. So yeah, it's also want to talk about fiber. So resistant starch kind of starts acting like a fiber. Fiber too. So we're just now learning about really how fiber affects us. Like gut bacteria, all this research is new. All our bacteria loves to eat is all the different fibers from food, but there's so many. There's oligosaccharides. All these different fibers. So soluble and insoluble is kind of an old school term. That's like this general category. They rarely are testing which fibers from plants dissolve in water and which ones don't, and they just like stick them in two buckets, soluble fiber and insoluble fiber. Doesn't necessarily mean that's or affect how it's gonna react in your body. But in general, you can kind of digest about half the calories from soluble fiber and about none of the calories from insoluble fiber, but there's exceptions. Some different types of soluble fiber, you can digest almost full calories, almost acts more like a carbohydrate. And some insoluble fiber, you know, most of it you don't digest any calories, meaning it just kind of passes through and is that bulk and roughage that ends up being food. But some of that insoluble fiber you can digest if you have the right bacteria to break down those nutrients. So,
Can you give some examples of those?
Yeah, absolutely. I actually had more slides that I actually cut out because I wanted to like save some time, but. So, soluble fibers are things like inulin, that's found in like onions. Soluble fibers tend to be the ones that will really affect your gut, either for good or for bad. It tends to be the ones that will either give you gas or won't. So insoluble fibers are like the cellulose and like the plant cell wall material that would just pass right through.
So this is like, so the insoluble is more like lettuce?
Yeah, so like a kale or lettuce, like the stalk of a kale, that's all the insoluble fiber. Like you can eat that, but it's just gonna like pass right through. Like it's not a lot you can actually digest in there. But the leaf itself has a lot of soluble fiber. Like it's still roughage, but your body can totally break that down.
Okay.
Partly. So.
So
dense.
Hey,
okay, so before we get into the diets, last thing I want to talk about, we talked about protein, fats, and carbs. I want to talk about calories a little bit and like, do calories actually matter? Right, like I feel like we've all had like our one friend who's like into physics. He's like, it's just physics, bro. Calories in, calories out. It's just energy, right? Like talking about the first law of thermodynamics is kind of like where you start with a change in energy. That's what delta E means. The system is just like the energy in minus energy out. If you take that to humans, we're talking about what we care about today. We're talking about change in fat mass. Like that's like the energy you have packed all over your body equals the energy you consume minus the energy you expend that day, right? So I'm actually stealing this from Peter Attia, one of his blog post articles. Really good. He's like a longevity doctor. He's leading the keto diet. Super smart guy. So this is one of his things. So we're just going to kind of expand on this a little bit because I think the calories in, calories out model, it's not wrong. It's not necessarily right. It's just more complicated than that because I'll show you in a sec here, right? So change in fat mass equals what you eat minus what you expend. Easy, right? Well, what does what you expend actually mean? So digestion, it actually takes calories to break down food. So you actually have to kind of invest a little bit of calories. So that counts against your overall total. Your exercise for the day, obviously, counts into that effect. Your daily activity, basal expenditure, and there's things like your heart has to beat, there's like muscles in your guts, like squeeze food. That all takes calories, and like you're not necessarily doing anything about it. But like all that stuff takes energy throughout the day, and like it's different for all of us depending on what our physiology is. So what the real picture is, and really there should be arrows all over the place, is that all this stuff actually affects each other, and this can actually be really empowering if you look at it in a certain way. You think about it, when you exercise, that's gonna maybe make you wanna eat something that's maybe a little different, or like you're craving something healthy and like wanna reward yourself. Or maybe you go the other way and you eat something unhealthy and you start a downward cycle. But like either way, something over here can affect something over here, which then affects your digestion, which then affects what you're craving the next day, which then affects if you wanna work out the next day. You know what I mean? Like all these things actually affect each other, and so a small tweak in your diet, timing, adding a food, removing a trigger food, or adding food that's giving you can have such a tremendous knock-on effect of, like the rest of your life that you don't need to look at changing your diet as like I need to overhaul everything. I want to encourage you guys as we're about to jump into these diets to think about just like small tweaks so you can take out, so you can remove like a small change in timing that could maybe have one of those knock-on effects and start affecting everything else, right? Mm-hmm. So, especially with this more advanced
good.
Group, right?
Yeah, it's good.
You guys are all experimenting all the time, but I think there's all stuff we can all learn. So, basically what I'm saying, so what is a diet at the end of the day? It's gonna be one of these three things. We're either changing when we eat our meals, we're either adding foods, or we're taking foods away. So, you might as well look through, just like start thinking about, am I eating this one food too much? Should I start taking that out? Should I start adding in these other foods, these other food groups? Or should I start changing the timing? I think it's a big part of it. And what goes into it? Well, like we said, our gut biome, all of us have different genetics as well. It's kind of unchangeable, but that's also going to affect how we can break down certain nutrients, things like folate, vitamin B, all that stuff. Really, it's totally determined by what our parents gave us, and we're just kind of working, and we're all doing the best we can with what our parents gave us. So, as well as schedule, right? When you work and when you work out has a huge effect on your diet. Like, another reason not every diet's going to work for everybody, not every fasting window is going to work for everybody. It's like, we all have different schedules. Like, we're all trying to be the best version of ourselves, and that's very different for all of us. And as well, our social environment, like eating food with people that you love, is like so important, I think. And I'll schedule my whole diet around that at the end of the day. Like, that's almost the most important thing. I'll kind of figure out all the rest of the stuff. And so, that's just at the end of the day, telling you about what's important to you. So, first diets I want to talk about all involve fasting. So, I want to talk a little bit about why we actually care about fasting. It's like we're basically changing when we eat our meals. Basically, fasting affects everything that affects your long-term health. With all these long chronic blood markers, fasting basically improves as far as your lipid profile, your cholesterol, decreases inflammatory responses, it decreases that overall blood glucose, so your overall exposure to blood sugar is lower, which is exactly what you want. And like we were saying before, it's not always actually good to be anabolic. Like, you need that balance because catabolism is like the opposite in general, and there's this particular word called autophagy that's coming up more and more in research, which is this idea of your body breaking down its own tissues selectively. It's a cool process because it's really tied into anti-aging because all of your cells regenerate, and what you want to do is like tell your body to regenerate the weaker tissues first and then replace them with stronger ones when you can. And so when you're in this catabolic state, before you start freaking out in full-on like starvation mode, whatever that means, if you haven't eaten for like weeks and weeks, but if you just haven't eaten for a few hours, your body's just gonna start breaking down tissues for energy, and that's exactly what you need. Like, you don't, you actually wanna break down those older tissues, so you wanna keep that balance, anabolic and catabolic. So here's a couple of different, here's one schedule for intermittent fasting that works for some people. It's called the Lean Gains Method. And this is where they just restrict their eating window and they only eat in between noon and 8 p.m. every day, 7 days a week, and that's just the schedule that works for them. They just basically, this is like the skipping breakfast diet. A lot of people have found
easy,
huge
actually.
Success. Yeah. And I think for like 80% of us, that would be great. I mean, and again, all diets work, I think, in some ways because they kind of tend to restrict your calories. And so a lot of people are trying to lose weight, they start intermittent fasting. And if you're literally just not allowing yourself to eat food in like these hours of the day, I think you're probably just gonna overall eat less and people see some effects from that. There's also that whole idea of getting your metabolism a break, letting your blood sugar regulate. That's really, really important too. So this is like a great kind of beginner method. One thing that is really prevalent in everything about fasting is that it affects women and men differently, and that typically men can tolerate a window where they can eat in a smaller window and fast longer, and women typically need to eat more often before their hormones start suffering, which is super important. So I have no idea what that is. If women's hormones are more, you know, tied into nutrition, and like you'll immediately stop that reproductive cycle if you feel like you don't have an abundance of nutrients, or if it's just a physical thing. I mean, capacity-wise, some women have a harder time eating enough food, where a lot of guys can totally cram all the calories they need into like one or two meals. A lot of women just physically stature-wise, and men too, like it just depends on, but I think just overall, I think women tend to need more time to eat just to get enough calories in, because I think if you're not trying to lose weight, calorie restriction is a bad idea. Like, you want your body to, most of the time, feel like it has an abundance of energy, always ready to go, so.
I got a question on that one.
Yeah.
Just playing the devil's advocate side, what about the leptin response? Can you speak on that at all?
I don't know much about the leptin response in response to fasting. What were you thinking about?
So the leptin response is essentially that, like, when you go without food for such a long time, your body produces this leptin, and the leptin is meant to hang on to calories more and more in the response to starvation. So I haven't eaten for 5 days, and I come across a big meal, I eat that meal, and all that leptin is going to say, hang on, store this extra fat, store it in places that we can go and grab it later.
Got it.
So that's, like, one of the concepts I found doing intermittent fasting diet.
Is that when you go back and find you just start packing on pounds?
Boy, in those like in that like 10th, 12th, 15th hour, more and more leptin is being built up in your body, and then you go and have your first meal, and your body's response is like store. So instead of facilitating the usage, it goes into store.
You know, I've read a lot about that, Brian, but I think from my own experience, because I've been doing this a lot, I'm losing weight like crazy.
There you go.
I think it also depends on what you eat. If you're eating a lot of carbs while you do that, like. Then you're spiking your insulin.
Yeah.
You know, I would think if you're doing fat, I don't know. It's
interesting. No, I've heard that.
I know that's very individual as well, because I know that like leptin is also related to this other hormone called ghrelin, which is related to appetite. Like, some people are chronically low and like have a hard time eating enough. Some people are constantly overstimulated. And like, so how does diet affect you on a day, hourly basis is like probably totally individual as well.
Yeah.
So maybe somebody like you might respond to like not fasting, like not doing like a 14-hour fast, but maybe doing something more like this, where you literally fast for 24 hours once a week, you get over that kind of hump of leptin, you let your body start just switching metabolism, let it totally calm down, and then you can start releasing food like the next day or something.
Yeah.
Okay, it's hard. I wish blood tests were cheaper, to kind of like keep track of stuff throughout the day. It'd be so interesting.
Just
be
hooked up to a monitor.
Yeah, seriously. Because how you feel, like, is everything, and if you're feeling like crap by the end of the day, or you feel like you just need to eat so much, and then you feel like it's all about how you feel at the end of the day. So it's interesting. Yeah.
Cool.
So this is another version where you just fast 1 day a week for 24 hours, and then that's the only fasting you do. So another fasting type diet that I think is really interesting. So this is a brand new book that came out by a guy named Dr. Walter Longo. And this is called the Longevity Diet is the name of the book, but his diet is called the Fasting Mimicking Diet. And he is actually recognizing that a lot of the benefits of fasting don't actually kick in until day 2 or 3.
Yeah.
They're talking about a lot of those real benefits, but that's so hard to do, right? So he's helping with compliance, like he's thinking about how can we actually get people to do this in a certain setting. So he does the Fasting Mimicking Diet, where you're not fully fasting, you're just eating way less calories than you usually do for about 5 days. So a lot of these foods that I brought here, he actually has things like fresh olives, almonds, dark chocolate, like all those foods are foods that you're going to be eating, because it's all about just like big flavor, nutrient dense, but like really reducing calories, really cutting protein for about 5 days,
and letting your body really dip into those stores and really get kind of catabolic for a while, but also not letting your body freak out. I think for some people, if you just get just a little bit of calories, like I think your body's just going to calm down, like we're good, but also kind of switch our energy system for a little while. Be really helpful. He also has things like herbal teas and stuff, just to kind of help your tongue. It's just, that can be really hard for some people. Like food is emotional. For some people, they love it. Some people love keto because it's just like simplifies things. Like, I don't care what it tastes like. I love to not eat for 5 days. Some people are kind of more like that, which is different for everybody, right? I think that diet's super interesting. I'm like, this is some of the effects that you're seeing of periodic fasting mimicking diet. You're already seeing reduction in diabetes and cancer and all kinds of disease. So pretty interesting stuff. So this is actually like a general guideline that I actually subscribe to in general that I've actually found very helpful. So this is another kind of tweak to your meal timing. This is like old school performance stuff, athletes, this is like NFL stuff a little bit too. But this is called carb backloading, and the idea is just basically you just shove your carb macronutrient toward the end of the day, and you keep your breakfast and your lunch, if you're going to eat them or when you eat them, to more higher fat, higher protein, and just get those carbs at the end of the day. And I've actually found that really works well for me. I actually do have a big spike in blood sugar, I think. I haven't actually done that Rotwolf test yet. I'm going to wait and see if I have any lancets, because Heather's been testing her blood sugar because she's in her third trimester to test for diabetes, and like maybe when she's got some lancets done, I'd love to kind of test, but yeah, I haven't done it yet, but I do know that I feel like crap if I eat a bunch of carbs for breakfast, and so I just don't do it, but I do feel better. Like I know my long distance runs, I feel so much better if I had a nice carb-heavy dinner the night before, and I kind of wake up, I feel light, but I feel like my muscles are full of glycogen, like I have good workouts that way too. So if I just shove toward the end of the day, it actually works perfectly for my physiology, because carbs make me tired, but I'm going to bed anyway, like I'm just like watching Game of Thrones or something, like that's fine, like that's kind of like the desired effect. So carbs don't really give me energy like right afterwards, so I just kind of time them at the end. So for some people, they might consider like, you need your carbs, just like shove them to the end of the day and like up the fat content of your breakfast and lunch. So this is kind of a representation. This is kind of, I want to talk about paleo a little bit. So this is like your general government recommendation, and this is like a simplified paleo, man. I keep it super simple. I don't count macros. I don't count calories. For me, the it might be shifted a little bit more towards plants. Maybe more like 2/3 plants and 1/3 animals, depending on like my activity that day and like also what you mean by animals. I don't think your plate should be like half muscle meat necessarily. But if you're talking about things like egg yolks and liver and like things giving those other nutrients as well, and like animal products in general.
And so water.
Butters in there. And water. Keep your coffee.
Just right? Water.
But like, yeah, just plants. But like this is good for some people. I don't actually like strict guidelines for my personal diet. I'm a little bit more just like more healthy foods, less not healthy foods, just kind of trying to shift myself one way or the other. Some people need more strict guidelines. That's where these other diets are better. But paleo is a little bit more just like eat ancestrally. Like it really, the definition of paleo is not strict, and this is kind of a little frustrating as somebody who's like literally in the paleo industry, but like it's also really liberating because there's no one person that controls what paleo means, and it actually has kind of continued to evolve and continue to just be healthy, really. Like I don't even know what paleo means anymore. It's like gluten-free and grain-free, but it's changed over time. It's, we're not trying to replicate what our ancestors ate necessarily, we're just using that to inform our decisions. But to me, paleo just kind of means eating healthy and just kind of keeping in mind how we evolved and like thinking about those foods. With our genetics too, like we evolved with ancestors who were eating certain foods and we're like better off probably eating foods close to what our ancestors ate. Yeah. But we shouldn't replicate it, we're just trying to be healthy overall. So that's my version of paleo, so that's kind of how we do it. This one's really interesting. So now we're gonna start talking about diets where we're gonna start systematically taking foods away. So this diet is massively popular right now. Like we have separate menus at a restaurant for the autoimmune paleo diet. People are asking for it like multiple times per day. And you'd think it'd be more of a niche diet, but it's really not. And I think it's because people have had so much success with it. And it's one of these diets where it seems so restrictive in the beginning, but she set it up where you remove all of these potential trigger foods. And then you're in like stage one of autoimmune paleo diet. You're on a fairly restricted diet, high in like lots of broths and vegetables, you know, like your typical kind of cleansing diet. But she's really good about kind of ordering these foods into like, which are the most likely and the least likely to kind of inflame your immune system. And so you just kind of systematically introduce them from the bottom up, starting with egg yolks, and then your certain spices, and then some ghee and butter from dairy, and some seeds, and things like that, nuts. So like systematically bringing back in these foods and then seeing how they affect you. Because I think that's the number one effect of these elimination diets. A lot of times it's so hard to pin down how a food affects you. Like when I eat gluten, I don't feel it until the next day. I have a weird stomach ache, and like the food that I eat suddenly gives me a stomach ache because it's inflamed from the day before. It's like really hard to pick out actually what foods are inflaming. And if there's like a food that you're eating every day that's causing inflammation, it's hard to tie that down because it can start causing other foods to inflame you. So you go on a diet like this, if you think you might have an issue, you think you can improve it. And then it's suddenly so easy to see when all you've changed from this week to last week is I've only added these three new foods and suddenly I feel so different. That's where I think the benefit to everybody can be for these foods is just giving yourself that A-B test every once in a while, like how are these foods actually making you feel, because you're actually giving yourself a bit of control and break from certain foods. So
especially the coffee. I think some people overdo coffee so much, they wonder why they feel like crap.
Yeah, people think there's energy in coffee. Like, there's zero calories.
There's acid in coffee.
It's literally liquid stress. Like, if you're like causing a stressor to your body to dump some hormones and dump fat from your fat stores to like have energy, because it's like you're literally sticking to your body. It's like liquid fear, basically. I think that's what Kelly Starrett from Supplement called liquid fear.
I like coffee. I'm just saying. Like, I see these people who drink four cups of coffee a day, and I'm like, dude.
I mean, everybody's brain chemistry is different, but yeah, and that also has effects on things like melatonin and like a whole host of other things.
That's why I can
Bulletproof. Diet.
I actually had a problem when I first discovered Bulletproof coffee. I drank way too much coffee and really messed myself up for a couple of weeks because it was just so delicious, and I was like getting those healthier calories, but I was just like way overstimulated. So that's autoimmune paleo. I think all of us deal with inflammation in some ways, and like in a way, all of us deal with autoimmune issues of like your own immune system being overstimulated by the food that we're eating. So I think it's good for all of us to kind of consider like what foods might be inflaming. Mm-hmm. All of us deal with inflammation on a daily basis. So
I got a question about the coffee.
Yeah.
I'm a big coffee person, so I have to get a little defensive.
Sorry, no.
Is it the coffee or is it caffeine? Like, would your mushroom coffee that only has like 40 grams of caffeine per serving, would that have a similar effect as coffee? Because also in coffee are some good healthy things as well.
I think she removes coffee specifically for the effect on your adrenals.
Okay.
So I think that would be related just to the caffeine. So I think that's why the main issue there.
Because I've honestly been looking into the mushroom coffee because of the lower caffeine.
Exactly, yeah. I think that's probably a cool thing. Like, there's a lot of ways to get energy and like, it's all about tolerance too. Caffeine tolerance changes so fast as adenosine receptors upregulate so quickly in your brain that like taking a small break, like you only need enough for it to work. Like more coffee isn't better. It only is better for some people because they've messed themselves up with too much tolerance at the time. Just desensitized, right? Like you only need a few milligrams to actually get the maximum effect if you're like sensitive to it. So
there's not
like to think about it.
It's not like a compounding effect. It's like it's open and then that's it.
What do you mean?
Like with the caffeine, you can't just like drink more and then it's like more energy. It's like once it's open, once the adrenal gland is open.
Oh, there's definitely a saturation. So basically the caffeine molecule competes with this molecule called adenosine for this one receptor, and it stops your body from, adenosine signals to your body that you're tired. And so if you're just flooding your brain with caffeine, that adenosine molecule can't ever hit that signal. So you don't actually, it keeps delaying your tired feeling. But that's also where you get that effect of like, as soon as that caffeine is finally broken down by your system, your body suddenly has all this adenosine that's been waiting to attach, and suddenly all those hit those receptors as adenosine receptors, and suddenly you feel super tired.
Huh.
So it's more of just like a curve effect of like, as your body, as it kind of hits peak concentration of caffeine, you can maintain it for as long as you can, but your body's always kind of breaking that stuff down, and eventually it kind of catches up. And those other natural molecules go back in the slots they were meant to be, and then you feel that natural tiredness that your body's been trying to signal to you for a while.
I read something about caffeine prevents the breakdown of adrenaline. That's a part of it too.
Interesting. I know it causes the release of things like norepinephrine and like adrenaline.
And then like once your body's like, okay, we got tons of whatever, and then once you run out, then it's just like crash.
Yeah.
Because your body isn't having it.
Exactly. Yeah. Like you only have limited amounts of all of these hormones. And caffeine is causing you to artificially release them ahead of time, like because your body's been saving them up for like a stressful event.
Right.
And you're just like, now's the time. Like you're like chemical signal. Like, so, yeah, it's good, but it's like drinking it all day is like completely missing the point, basically. It's like a specific thing, right?
Okay.
I got something to add, too. In addition, your brain will create more of those adenosine receptors because you're forcing so much caffeine into it and filling those receptors. It's like, oh, there's too much I've got to fill. I've got to create more.
Right.
And then when you stop taking coffee, you get that stronger, tired response.
Yeah.
Stronger.
More tired than you would have been in the first place.
Right. Because there's so many more receptors.
It's expecting caffeine almost.
Your brain's like, kick in because I can't get these adenosine into their receptors. So I've got to create more. And then once those receptors aren't filled, Yeah. And it just goes crazy.
It's a real deal.
Yeah.
We've all felt that.
All of
it's
our
additional area, it's addiction, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The brain has that same addictive response to any kind of drug or alcohol.
We have some heavy caffeine drinkers, and they're all not here, so
yeah.
You're not going to get a lot of pushback.
Well,
on this.
Yeah, that sounds a little.
And getting coffee is like, it's so, like, coffee is just
another program. Like, you should be drinking coffee. It's super good for you. It's, like, good for your heart. It's good for your brain. It's just about, like, the smart piece of it. Like,
okay.
Like, yeah, like, not necessarily more better.
This is a cool diet. I don't know if you guys have seen this TED Talk by a woman named Terry Walls, who basically, like, went from not being able to walk to, like, completely reversing her multiple sclerosis through its diet. But I think that, again, multiple sclerosis is this autoimmune condition that for her had become really advanced, but she was really able to turn it around. But all of us deal with, I think, these autoimmune type issues and inflammation. And so what I like about her diet is, instead of like taking away food for the autoimmune paleo diet, she's got a really prescriptive, like, here's what you should be eating every day. And I actually try to do this if I can. Like, that is like, I feel like I did good for my day if I can get all this. So it's 3 cups each, 3 cups of greens, 3 cups of multicolored vegetables, and then 3 cups of what she calls like sulfurous or other vegetables. So things like garlic, onions, mushrooms, stuff like that. So it's kind of a good guideline to consider. Like, you're really, if you track your minerals and you can actually achieve this, your number's gonna be rocking, your magnesium, your potassium, like, you're just gonna be covering your bases just by getting in all this vegetable matter. So
cool.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. It's one of my favorite, just like 3 cups of each. 9 cups, it sounds like a lot, but that's 9 cups raw. So you cook it down, it gets a little smaller. Like, it's actually not that hard if you actually kind of try to commit to it.
I like blend too.
Yeah,
make a
there
shake.
You go, man.
And
yeah,
like 9 servings of fruits and veggies.
There's not a single diet that's like eat less vegetables.
Right.
Not a single one. Like, it's about which vegetables should you eat, which are ideal, but like everybody has a benefit from more vegetables. So.
Well, you become satiated too, so you
don't
eat as much, right?
Yeah.
Like, oh, I'm gonna go eat some potato chips.
Yeah.
You just ate 3 cups of kale.
And I also really think it's that range of fibers that you find in fruits and vegetables are just so important for your gut. Like, that's where you get those breakdown products that your gut just feeds on, right? Like, 90% of the serotonin circulating in your body was created directly by the bacteria in your gut. Like, the other 10% was created by your body's own natural processes, but 90% of it, serotonin is connected to things like, you know, depression and feelings of isolation, loneliness. Like that really affects how you feel, how you see the world, right? And like, 90% of it's affected by your gut. And they can only make that serotonin if you give them the right fibers with which to kind of break down. So,
quick question.
Yeah.
I'm just looking at this picture and I see the grapefruit there. I'm like, one of those things is not like the other. It's the only real like fruit. On that.
Yeah.
On that slide. What is this person's take on fruit? Because I know there's a lot of natural sugar in fruit.
Yeah.
The glucose does spike your insulin.
For sure.
It takes too much. But I know grapefruit is a low glycemic, or it's a super low glycemic fruit.
Yeah, and just lower sugar in general compared to like an orange of the same size. And I think that is probably why that's here. She tends to recommend the lower sugar stuff. The blueberries, so if you're going to eat fruit.
Cranberries.
Yeah, they have like really nutrient dense. But again, especially if you're dealing with an autoimmune issue, sugar can be incredibly inflammatory.
Yeah,
and you want to watch that. It's like a balance of like getting all those nutrients you need from fruit, but you can get a lot of those multicolored things without all the sugar if possible. So I think that's why I should recommend grapefruit specifically.
Mm-hmm.
Grapefruit is actually really interesting. Grapefruit contains a compound called naringin that actually slows down your metabolism of caffeine. So if you eat like a half grapefruit with your morning coffee, you should feel that caffeine much more strongly and like longer throughout the day. Like, it's supposed to, like, your circulating caffeine stays much longer.
So it should mix that.
And grapefruit actually interacts with a ton of other medications. Like, you'll see on the back of a ton of drugs in the pharmacy, like, don't eat grapefruit with this. Because this particular compound, it affects like the cytochrome P450, I think, like just this one enzyme that's affected in a whole bunch of stuff in your brain. So,
dang, that's cool.
Next up, a keto. I think all you guys are pretty familiar with keto. This is the general macros we're talking about, 70-25-5. I think people do different versions. I really am concerned about over-consuming protein, and like, people on keto, like, if you tend to cut carbs, people just tend to replace it with more protein. And I really think keep your protein the same, like, watch that protein intake, and just increase the fats. Like, there aren't those same dangers of over-consuming fat at all. Like, I think your body will tell you when you've had enough, and as long as it's from healthy sources, I think that's exactly what you need. So just don't over-consume the protein, even on keto. I think that could really be a real danger here.
So, sorry, maybe this is oversimplification, but when you say like a healthy fat, like a healthy source of fat, like could you just give some examples? I know we talked a little bit about butter, like oils and stuff like that.
It's so, I mean, so that you can find studies showing the health benefits of a lot of these healthy sources of fat, but what's gonna work for you is so dependent for each of us. Some people feel great eating a steak, and some people feel better eating a salmon fillet. Like, I actually got my genetic testing results back from a company called 23andMe.
Yeah.
And they actually showed that I actually metabolize poly and monounsaturated fats a lot better.
Okay.
So I should shift more of my fat towards salmon, more olives. And I actually don't feel great eating a lot of tallow or a lot of lard. Really heavy saturated fat, I don't actually feel great. I love eating my steaks and stuff, but as far as cooking oils, that actually helped kind of shift me more toward like the macadamia nut oils and the avocado for me, because I need less of the saturated fats just for my own metabolism. But people are different. I mean, saturated fat has this whole host of health effects.
Yeah.
And I really think that's part of why you see all these mixed results. Like, there's a study that came out this year from the American Heart Association about the potential dangers of saturated fats. But the results were completely mixed, and like not everybody metabolizes those fats the same, so it's really hard to make recommendations on that stuff.
Okay.
So I think it's sticking to the general paleo principles of whole foods and like healthy sources and animals that are eating a healthy diet is all gonna affect that fat composition. But I think like the ratios or which ones you should be eating the bulk of your diet come from is like so individual, it's so hard to say. It's tough. I mean, I don't feel great eating a lot of nuts. Some people eat snack on nuts all day. If I eat a bunch of almonds, I feel really lethargic and slow. Like, I don't feel good eating them for whatever reason. So, just depends. I mean, almonds are super good for you. I eat them in moderation, but if I eat like a half a jar of almond butter, like, I really feel like crap. And I can do it. Like, sometimes that's what my body wants, but I shouldn't do that. It's like confession time. Sounds like that's good too. So different types of keto diets. This is, I think, Anton, I think you found this interesting. So there's these other two types. So like standard keto is just like all the time, try to be in ketosis, which is like linear carbs, 20 to 50 grams of carbohydrate. But there's two other ones. So cyclical is one that I'd heard of for the last couple of years, which is where you're kind of dipping in and out of it from a day-to-day basis. Maybe you spend a couple days really restricting your carb on more of a standard keto diet, and then for a couple days you just refeed and let your body eat those carbohydrates, eat the potatoes, and have a couple hundred grams, and let those glycogen stores replenish, because that really is important. So like those muscle stores and your liver stores of glycogen replenish eventually. The other one is the targeted ketogenic diet, which is more a lot of the CrossFit athletes are starting to incorporate this as well, where you just eat 20 to 50 grams of net carbs approximately 30 minutes to an hour right before you're about to work out. So yeah, I think that's pretty just like carb cycling basically.
Yep.
And like you're gonna be very probably insulin sensitive as long as your metabolism is nice and healthy, and you're gonna probably use those carbs real quick, like that body's been waiting for it. It's probably a good time to do it. So if you are maybe looking for a little boost, like I think ketone supplements are really interesting. I think the performance benefits are you just can't deny it. And like the health effects are like to be determined. I think a lot of it is proven in the pudding. If you feel good, you're probably healthy, but you never know on that stuff. So I think it's just like a balance of like figuring out these different nutrients. One thing that I would caution you guys with these ketone supplements is this is not the kind of thing that you just want to take a scoop of ketone supplement and never having done keto before and think you're going to have the same effects as a keto diet. Like, so there are, so the keto diet is beneficial for a whole list of things, and those ketones in your blood do signal to your body to start these like anti-inflammatory responses. And so you can almost think, if you read some of the research, that if you just get those ketones in your blood by eating it, that you'll get the same thing. But really it's like, a lot of the benefits of keto are getting your body into the state where it's making ketones itself.
Yeah.
And then if it just needs a little bit more ketones to feel energized for a workout, that's where the supplements
are. Come on in, Antonio.
Hey, I'm scared. We're just finishing that burger.
Yeah, we are almost.
And some other girl just walked up.
It was just Liz. It's a lot quieter in here without her.
Okay, so last thing I want to talk about, and this is like one that I actually really love, but this is kind of why I want to get back to the Bruce Lee idea of like taking the good stuff. Is like so many diets out there are like pushed by this charismatic figurehead that's going to tell you this is the end all be all, or that their product is the one that's going to help you out the most. And like Bulletproof Diet is no exception. I love what this guy's doing for the most part, but he's definitely in there to make money, and it's just about taking the good, like Bruce Lee would say, and like not and ignoring the bad. So I was looking at this thing. I love. He's got these three different graphs of like. And this is how I tend to eat, a little bit more wishy-washy, a little more like keep your foods more in this area, less in this area. But I was like, wouldn't protein isolate? That seems weird.
Yeah,
like, I was like, factory farmed meat is like not as good as grass fed, but it's way better than like an isolate of whey. There's like so many nutrients in eggs too. And I'm like, oh yeah, he's like talks about cross filtering, how he has to, like, oh, he sells whey protein isolate. That's like a that's why. Okay. Everybody's trying to sell something. So I think it's just about like you can't throw out the baby with the bathwater, but you also don't want to like buy a whole hog, right? So that's what goes with all that stuff. Like that fasting mimicking diet, that guy sells packs of almonds and olives. You can buy it and you're like spending like $25 a day for like 600 calories of it. You know, he takes all that money and puts it into the research. So I think he's more like on the positive side of it. He's like not just in it to make a buck, but that's what it is. So I like these bulletproof diagrams. You don't need to buy the book, but I think these diagrams are awesome. Just like general rules of like, where's the bulk of my calories coming from? Mm-hmm. Veggies and fruits too. So yeah, common themes. So from all these diets, I think diversity is better. Experiment with different fruits and vegetables. But at the same time, if you're really focusing on nutrient-dense stuff and you know what works for you, I don't think eating generally the same thing every day is necessarily bad at all. Like, if you're focusing, like you said, on nutrient-dense foods already, you're already kind of trying to cover your bases, so.
Just try to eat a huge salad and a lot of cow.
It's a lot of cow. That sounds pretty good, man. That's about my diet, too. That's awesome. So in general, I think more fat, less carbs, and moderate protein is like all of these diets. Like I'm just trying to like, this page was just like, this is the final page. I'm just trying to figure out the themes from all of these diets and like try to figure out some common themes. More organ meat, something I didn't necessarily specifically talk about today, but when we're talking about animal products, like muscle meat is one thing, but the liver is so good for you. What's that?
Hot dogs. Dogs.
Oh, who knows? It's, yeah, probably organ meat too.
Good ones.
Yeah, exactly. Restrict the feeding window and not eating every meal is good for most of us, probably 80%, but for 20% of us that have a hard time getting enough, you can definitely eat more of that. Overall, less grains, and then more omega-3, less omega-6. So all stuff we've heard before. But I think it's just about figuring out like what food's going to add in, what food's going to take out, and realizing there's that whole knock-on effect of like really small changes. So,
awesome.
That's great, bro.
So good, Joe.
Thanks, man.
Awesome.
Yeah, I got a bunch of samples too. I know you guys got protein shakers, different mixes and stuff.
And he'll be hanging out if you guys have any questions.
Yeah.
Show me all that.
Yes.
Oh my god, things are going off. I'm ready to work out.
What makes you want to eat more food? No,
what is that?
It's a potentialist for me, but that's not
jumping into keto. That's
mushrooms off.